I'm the Reverend Munro Sickafoose, and it's good to be back in this pulpit again. It's been a while. A lot of familiar faces and some new ones. I was thinking about Palm Sunday, which is today in the Christian liturgical calendar. And this is the day when Jesus is welcomed into Jerusalem, riding on a donkey, and the people are laying palm fronds down in front of him, like they did with Pilate a few years earlier when he rode in on his war horse to be the new Roman governor of the province of Judea. And what strikes me about this story is that just a few days later, those same people are crying, "Give us Barabbas." And so Pilate does exactly that, frees Barabbas, and crucifies Jesus in his place. And the lesson for me in that is, beware the madness of crowds. Groupthink, the mob. Because the mob will turn on a dime, and one day they will feed you and raise you on their shoulders, and the next day they'll be crying for your head. And of course the question comes up then is, well, let me back up just a tiny bit here. You know, it's hard to go against the crowd sometimes. It's hard to stand up and speak out against things that you might see going wrong, particularly when it's in your group, your political party, whatever, your group of neighbors and friends, because we all want to belong. And it's really hard to go against the grain, so to speak. But like Jerusalem at the time of Christ, we are now in this sort of seething sea of sects and political parties and entrenched interests. And it seems almost deliberate that we are being pitted against each other on so many levels, for so many different reasons, over so many different divisions, and race and class and color and gender and all this kind of stuff. And for me, the question is, cui bono? Who benefits? And of course, the people that benefit the most against us getting together is the wealthy and the powerful. They seek to keep us divided. And so our job, I think, as a religious people, or just people in general, is to begin to heal those divides, to begin to bring people together, no matter how hard that may be. The waters are really troubled right now. And I know the old spiritual says, sometimes you gotta trouble the waters, but sometimes you gotta calm them. And so, anyway, that's kind of my Palm Sunday little mini rant, but I was thinking about that on the way in this morning. It's just really important that we begin to bring people together. And it's really hard right now. So, anyway, make of that as you will. I'm going to turn the pulpit over to Greg here, and thank you for listening.
Good morning. I'm Greg Berg, your worship associate this morning. Please kindle your chalice at home as we kindle ours here. These words are from Peter Samotsky. May this flame we light remind us that every one of us can bring light of love to the world. May this clear flame be a symbol that every heart can burn bright with joy peace, and harmony. May the wisdom of ages speak to us through the flame and stay in us. Every one of us can be a blessing to the world.
Hello. We are so glad to have you with us in the treehouse this morning. My name is Kimmy Floyd Reich, and I'm the Program Ministry Director here at UU Santa Fe. My pronouns are they and she. This week, we are speaking about what it means to welcome a stranger. This month is also National Poetry Month, and one poet, William Butler Yeats, once famously said that a stranger is just a friend you haven't met yet. Today's Treehouse story reflects that same view of the world. Our story is an adaptation of Lubna and Pebble by Wendy Medor and Daniel Igneous. It was published in 2019 by Dial Books for Young Readers and is available here in our UU Santa Fe library or at a local library or favorite bookstore. Here is our story. Once there was a child named Lubna who lived in a tent city with her family. Her best friend was a pebble. Lubna had found the gray stone on the beach on her very first night when they arrived on the boat, right before she fell asleep in her daddy's salty arms. Lubna was afraid in the ocean of tents, but she knew her daddy and her friend the pebble would always keep her safe. And in a big white tent, Lubna found a pen, and that allowed her to draw a smiling face on her new round friend. Now her pebble could smile back at her. Lubna told her friend pretty much everything. And when she was with that silent friend, she always felt better when thinking about her brothers and her home and all that they had lost. A few months later, after a cold winter where the wind blew the tent flaps, a little boy arrived in the tent camp. The little boy did not say much at first, until one day Lubna noticed him and introduced him to her friend Pebble. Seeing Lubna's best friend, the little boy coughed and sneezed, and then he smiled. And then he looked down at Pebble and said, "Hello, my name is Amir." And soon Lubna and Amir were best friends too. They played hide and seek under the stars. But every night, Lubna reassured her friend Pebble that they too were still a best friend. One day, Lubna's dad came home and he was excited and happy. He announced that they had found a new home and that they would be going and leaving the tent city. Lubna was really happy too, until she told her friend Amir, who started to cry. That made Lubna sad too. And that night, Lubna asked Pebble what she should do. But Pebble, like always, didn't have much to say. But by the next morning, Lubna knew what she needed to do. And Lubna went up and she gave Amir her little shoebox with Pebble and the pen she used to draw his smiling face. Amir asked what to do if Pebble started missing Lubna. And Lubna told him to draw the smile back on his face and to keep smiling back. "What if I miss you?" asked Amir next. And Lubna told him that Pebble didn't speak much but was a great listener, so he could tell Pebble all about his feelings. And with that, Lubna got onto the boat that would take her to her new home, waving to Amir and Pebble standing on the shore. Like Lubna and Amir found, sometimes we meet people who arrive in our communities who are lonely and afraid. They might be strangers to us, but when we greet them with love and compassion, they can become friends. Have a great week. Thank you.
We pause for a moment and kindle this candle for peace and freedom in Ukraine and around the world. And we light our earth candle to acknowledge that we are living on the traditional lands of the Tanoan-speaking Tewa, Tiwa, Toa, and Karas peoples. We realize other Native people have also lived and moved through these lands, including the Apache, the Diné, the Hopi, and many others. We are forever grateful for their contributions and guidance. And as your worship associate this morning, it's a joy to welcome Reverend Munro Sickafoose to our pulpit. Munro received his Master of Divinity from the Star King School in 2013. He did his internship here at UU Santa Fe and was also ordained here as a minister in 2016. He serves as a community minister for us. Welcome. We also welcome Lydia Madrick and the Coda Women's Choir and take much joy in their music.
We have a number of entries in our Book of Joys and Sorrows this morning. There's a joy from Doug and Cheryl. It was a wonderful experience to attend the SF Gay Men's Chorus at the Lensic on Friday night, and it was a fabulous show. Our very own Chase Reeser was the first solo and did an amazing performance. Many thanks to the 69 members and friends who have made their 23-24 pledges. We have received $122,418, 38% of our $325,000 goal. Sorry. Please join us. Questions? See Roberta in the foyer. Maureen Redout shares a joy. She's grateful to have avoided COVID after close contact exposure. And a joy that warmer days are here at last, and we can begin to take off our winter coats. And from Nina Binnen, great news about Bev Hedden. Did I get that right? Bev has moved from Albuquerque back to Santa Fe, where she belongs, and is currently getting occupational and physical therapy at Christus St. Vincent Inpatient Rehab. She's busy with rehab in the mornings and some afternoons, so please either email or text or contact the nurse's station for her daily schedule, because she is eager for visitors. And I have a personal joy, which is that on April 12th, my good friend and author Trebby Johnson will be here on book tour for her new book, Fierce Consciousness, Surviving the Sorrows of Earth and Self. It's going to be a great evening. She'll do some readings, and we'll have some Q&A, so please come. And it is our custom to welcome visitors. And as I read your name and where you're from, you're welcome to give a little high five or something, but we don't expect anything else from you. Robin Locke from Kennesaw, Georgia. Robin and Evelyn Caldwell from Dallas, Texas. Rita Joyce from Santa Fe. Hannah Deleiden. Did I get that right? From Belgium? Close enough. Andrea Malcolm from Princeton, New Jersey. Denise Rice from Albuquerque. Teresa Lopez from Santa Fe. And Jay from Indianapolis. Welcome Encoded this morning as a preview of their concert on April 16th. Right. Where's the concert going to be? Right here. Okay. Please purchase tickets today from Lydia, and your tickets and the monies raised will go directly to UU Santa Fe. And now, if you'll join us in Spirit of Life, hymn number 123. I love that song. It always reminds me what it means to be a UU. Now, if you'll join me in a time of meditation and reflection, and I invite you, as you're comfortable doing so, to close your eyes, settle into your seats, place both feet on the floor, take a couple of long, slow, deep breaths. And as you exhale, let the cares and worries of the day and the week and the month just flow out of you, and down through your body, down through your feet, into the waiting arms of Mother Earth. And as you relax, find that still, small space at the center of your being, around which all of life and the world revolves. And I'm going to offer some words into that space for us to hold for a few moments. It's a poem by John O'Donohue, For Belonging. May you listen to your longing to be free. May the frames of your belonging be generous enough for your dreams. May you arise each day with a voice of blessing whispering in your heart. May you find a harmony between your soul and your life. May the sanctuary of your soul never become haunted. May you know the eternal longing that lives at the heart of time. May there be kindness in your gaze when you look within. May you never place walls between the light and yourself. And may you allow the wild beauty of the invisible world to gather you, mind you, and embrace you in belonging.
When all the world is a hopeless jumble and the raindrops tumble all around, heaven opens a magic lane. When all the clouds darken up the sky, there's a rainbow highway to be
reading this morning is from Matthew 25, verses 31 to 40. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he will sit on his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?" The king will reply, "Truly I tell you, whatever you did for any of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me."
I would guess that most of us know of the biblical story of the Good Samaritan. The broad outline, if not the details, chapter and verse. On the road to Jericho, a man, presumably Judean, has been beaten, robbed, and left for dead by the side of the road. A priest and then a Levite pass him by, each going to the other side of the road to create as much distance as possible between them. And then the Samaritan comes along. And you have to understand that at the time, Samaritans were pretty much on everybody's out-group list. But the Samaritan rescues the man, takes him to an inn, pays for his room and the wine and oil that will be needed for his recovery, and then goes his way. He doesn't calculate that the man he saved might have left him for dead were the circumstances reversed. He just sees another human being in need and does what he can do. He doesn't ask for anything in return. No repayment. He's not seeking recognition. He's forever nameless. This parable is held up as an example of how we should treat a stranger in need, without thought for which tribe the stranger belongs to, without thought for our own risk or the costs. It represents an ideal for such behavior. And like all stories, we're present in all the characters. We may recognize ourselves in the traveler left for dead, and the priest, the Levite, the innkeeper, or the Samaritan. But there's something missing from the story. Something critical to our notions of hospitality in law and custom. Because the story takes place in the wilderness, on the road from Jerusalem to Jericho, a road notorious for its danger. And it may seem obvious, but the road and the wilderness are not home to any of their characters. And hospitality requires a home dwelling, a home city, a home country. A safe place with boundaries, with borders. It requires an invitation, consent, and reciprocity. The philosopher Jacques Derrida saw hospitality as inviting and welcoming the stranger. And this takes place on different levels. There's the personal level where the stranger is welcomed into our home as a guest. And there's the individual level, or the level of individual countries, with immigrants and refugees. Now, many of the words that we associate with hospitality came out of an old Proto-Indo-European root, gosti. And it meant stranger and guest and host, depending on the context. And its underlining meaning was someone with whom one has reciprocal duties of hospitality. That word also evolved into the Latin hostis, meaning enemy and army and host, as in a multitude, and hostile. And the combination of that word and another root word, poti, meaning powerful, evolves into the Latin hospice, hospitable, hospital, hospitality, host, as in the giver of hospitality, hostage, and hostile. There's a lot tangled up in those roots. The Greek languages also evolved from that same Proto-Indo-European, and hosti gave us the Greek xenos, which also has the interchangeable meaning of guest, host, or stranger. And from xenos, we get the word xenophobia, fear or hatred of the foreign, but also the word xenophilia, the attraction to the stranger, to the new, to the unknown. The stranger may bring danger, but they might also bring new genes or new ideas or new technologies, new art, new poetry, new songs. And the words hospitality and hostility share roots because the stranger is an unknown. They could be a threat, bringing not just physical danger, but new and destabilizing ideas or beliefs, shaking up the status quo. In the beginning, we don't know. And so we have to ask, is there a threat here? How far do we trust this stranger? What are the limits of our hospitality? Because in the real world, not to ask those questions would be foolish. Hospitality is a reciprocal relationship between a host and a guest in a home, between a country and the refugee or the immigrant. And without that reciprocity, there can't really be hospitality because both host and guest are adrift. They don't know how to behave. They don't know what's expected of each and where the boundaries are that cannot and should not be crossed. Derrida made a distinction between unconditional hospitality, which he considered impossible, and normal hospitality, which in his view was always conditional. In trying to imagine the extremes of a hospitality to which no conditions are set, we realize that unconditional hospitality could never be accomplished. It's not so much an ideal, it's an impossible ideal. Because this is the dilemma of hospitality. On one hand, there is the moral imperative to show hospitality, especially to people in distress or fleeing from danger. And on the other hand, the total abandon of borders would obliterate the home into which they are being invited. All borders have some degree of permeability. But if they're absolutely open, then the border itself is abolished and there's no longer any place of safety, any home to enter. Hospitality assumes the ability to provide a safe haven. And like a filter, the border must inevitably be selective when allowing itself to be crossed. If refugees fleeing from persecutors find their way through an opening, it cannot be equally open to those pursuing them. Guests are expected to respect the home and the host and help preserve that safety, that refuge and its boundaries. And conversely, for a host to harm any guest in any way is a grievous violation of our obligation as a host to provide safety. And our nation is guilty of this violation in so many ways, presently and historically. Xenophobia rises from our ancient animal anxieties and fears of the unknown and the unfamiliar, and the potential danger that they might bring. And when times are troubled and the future is uncertain, our tribes get smaller and more defensive, more concerned with purity and enforcing right belief and right behavior as the tribe sees it. And we circle the wagons, seeing the external world as even more hostile and dangerous. But interestingly enough, it's not total strangers we have the most trouble extending hospitality to. It's outgroups. Sigmund Freud noted that it is precisely communities with adjoining territories and related to each other in other ways as well, who are engaged in constant feuds and ridiculing each other. What makes an outgroup? Proximity plus small differences. If you want to know who someone hates, find the group that lives closely intermingled with them and is most conspicuously similar to them, and chances are you'll find the group who they have years of seething hatred towards. 9 in 10 Americans think that the nation is more divided now than at any point in their lifetime. In a recent poll, roughly half of Democrats describe Republicans as ignorant, 54%, and spiteful, 44%, while a similar proportion of Republicans describe Democrats as ignorant, 49%, and spiteful, 54%. 61% of Democrats labeled Republicans racist, sexist, or bigoted, while just 31% of Republicans applied these terms to Democrats. Perhaps most concerning of all, more than 20% of Republicans and Democrats describe members of the other party as evil. Only 4% of both parties think the other side is fair, and even fewer describe them as thoughtful or kind. Many would rather their children married an atheist or someone of another race or religion than marry someone from the other party. So who now is the stranger? There's a sense in which we are all strangers now. Many of us no longer recognize the country we grew up in and no longer feel safe. And many of us never felt safe at all. Physical and emotional and political walls are going up everywhere these days, and our lives are riven by dozens of what appear to be insurmountable dividing lines. Politics and race and class and religion and nationality and sexuality, and the list just goes on and on and on. We're divided within and without, and wholeness seems impossible. And our alienation from each other makes us strangers to ourselves. Who's the stranger? Why, I am. You are. We are. They are whoever they are. And if we're all strangers, where is home and where is safety? You know, once upon a time in many cultures, there were customs that governed the relationship between hosts and guests, between a country and immigrants and refugees. And those are now uncertain at best and heavily contested at worst. Hospitality can be risky business. We should never pat ourselves on the back and complain we are a hospitable people. Instead, we must always be asking how we can become more hospitable while at the same time avoiding the collapse of the region of safety implied in the word home. And this isn't a liberal or a conservative thing. This is an ancient human conundrum. Welcoming the stranger is not just for their sake, but also for ours. Welcoming the stranger is the compassionate practice of facing down our own fears and anxieties, of learning to be more generous and welcoming in the face of risk. And we can never make that practice perfect. But we're not called to be perfect. We're called to be hospitable while preserving the safe places that make that possible. And this is a difficult dance, this tension between these two competing interests. Derrida's is not a philosophy that offers definitive answers to this question. Such answers would be wrong, because we're dealing with a true dilemma. Instead, he alerts us to the fact that we're always in the situation of never having done enough. And the hospitable person or country or organization should be seeking at all times to be more hospitable, alert to any opportunities to move in this direction, never saying, we've done enough, we can't do more, but always seeking practical ways to do more than we have, to somehow feed just one more person, to somehow shelter just one more family, to somehow welcome just one more person seeking freedom, one more person fleeing tyranny and persecution. May it always be so. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Holly Kinley, and my pronouns are she and her. I've been a member of this congregation since long, long before announcing one's program of pronouns was important or even imagined. After all, in 1978, when I signed the membership book, we were in the midst of the freewheeling 1970s. I want to share with you a little bit about the congregation in those early days so you might see why I am still an active pledging member. In the late 1970s, we were a fellowship of 20 to 30 committed UUs meeting in a small gray house on the old Santa Fe Trail. On Sunday mornings, we crowded into the living room on metal folding chairs, if you got there early and were lucky, and wooden benches otherwise. We did not have a minister. But we did have a program committee that arranged for Sunday programs led mostly by lay speakers and occasionally by a minister from Los Alamos on his Sunday off. Needless to say, the whole operation relied entirely on the tireless work of volunteers. But we were highly motivated by a strong sense of community and faith that what we were doing mattered not just to us, but to the larger community. In those days, the congregation was evenly divided between those favoring hiring a minister and those who were strongly opposed, fearing a loss of individual initiative and freedom. Through a program offered by the UUA, we were able to experiment with having a minister for a short period of time. The experiment was successful, and we voted to call our first minister. But before that could happen, fortune shone on us, and we were able to purchase this building, this very building we are in now, from the Mormons by selling a piece of land that had been gifted to us by Greer Garson and her husband, Buddy Fogelson. We eventually sold the house on the old Santa Fe Trail and paid off our mortgage. After moving into this building, we called our first minister, the Reverend Webster Kitchell, who quickly endeared himself to the nervous congregation with his delightful coyote stories and the caution he exercised in leading us from a culture of being a fellowship to that of being a real church. Under his leadership, our membership grew rapidly and greatly from just 40 or so when we arrived here to the hundreds. And all of this happened in just a few years. Our congregation and town were younger then, and we were able to have an active children's program and a paid part-time director. Music became an important part of our Sunday services. We grew a garden out where the fellowship hall now sits, participated in All Species Day, and then enlarged and remodeled the building. We initiated several social outreach programs, including quietly transporting undocumented immigrants north from the border and tutoring kids at a local junior high school. We had a lot of fun with organized hikes up to Lake Catherine, picnics in Hyde Park, campouts at the Great Sand Dunes and other places, and all of this in a very, very short period of time. Why am I telling you this story? We faced several really significant challenges in that early period of our history, buying a building and then renovating it, calling our first minister, raising money to pay the minister and meet our growing needs, just figuring out who we were and establishing our place in the community. And we met these challenges because we were highly motivated by a sense of commitment to our community, to our UU principles, and to our role and the role of those principles in our world. And we learned in that process that we could do anything we put our hearts and minds to. We're no different now. We remain a strong and vibrant community, as we demonstrated by meeting the challenge of the COVID pandemic with energy and creativity. We can still do anything we put our hearts and minds to. The board has asked for an 8.3% increase in budget and pledging for this year's budget, primarily to allow longer-term staff salaries to rise to the UUA guidelines. We can do this. Please complete and submit your pledge forms before the April 16th deadline. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm John Fawcett, he, him. I'm a member of the Board of Trustees, and we're about to pass the baskets. The amount that we collect on each Sunday is really minuscule compared to all that we need, but over a year, you know, 50 or so collections, we collect enough that it's equivalent to the budget of some of our major committees. So it really makes a difference. I'll pass the baskets now.
Scrolling, scrolling, scrolling.
that was very powerful. Thank you so much. I just love that song. Small but mighty. Amen. And if you, words of our chalice lighting, or by extinguishing, we extinguish our chalice flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of commitment, the warmth of community, or the fires of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. And now it's time for our benediction. Do we still hold hands and do the benediction? The benediction. Feel free to stand, although we will be sitting back down for the postlude. May love and skill guide our hands.
May love and skill guide our hands.
May love and courage fill our hearts.
May love and courage fill our hearts.
May love and wisdom light our minds.
May love and wisdom light our minds.
May love flow through us and walk among us.
May love flow through us and walk among us.
As we live our lives.
As we live our lives.
And work to heal our world.
Amen,
amen, shalom, and blessed be.
Amen.
Go in peace. Okay. Oh!
Thank you for joining us today, friends. We hope that you enjoyed today's service. Please take a little time and explore our website and visit our online welcome table if you'd like to know more about us. Otherwise, we'll see you next Sunday morning. Stay in touch and be well.